Greetings to all living in Sri Lanka and joining us from overseas. As we prepare to meditate on God's word this morning, let's pray and commit this time, asking the Lord to give us divine unction to understand and to comprehend His voice and His message to each of us. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank and praise You for another opportunity to sit at Your feet, listening to Your voice, to understand Your heart. We pray that we would not only be listeners this morning, but also be doers of Your word. Speak to us, for Your servants are listening, and help us also to apply and implement all that You reveal unto us this morning. We pray and ask this through Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Dear friends, I want to speak with you about a glorious homecoming. Ascension Day is forgotten by many in between Easter Sunday and Pentecost Sunday. These two are seen as two great events, and because Ascension Day is in between, many of us forget. And last Thursday was Ascension Thursday. But it is an important event for the Christian faith and for you and me who are followers of Christ. Ascension Day is truly important. I read to you from Acts chapter 1, verse 6 to 11, thinking of that glorious homecoming or heavenward travel journey of our Lord Jesus Christ after His ascension. So when they had come together, they asked Him, "Lord, is this the time when You will restore the kingdom to Israel?" He replied, "It is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by His own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you will be My witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth." When He had said this, as they were watching, He was lifted up, and a cloud took Him out of their sight. While He was going and they were gazing up towards heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw Him go into heaven." May the Lord be pleased to bless the reading of His word to all of us. Dear friends, the ascension is important to us because it affirms Jesus' resurrection and completion of His mission. It affirms Jesus' resurrection and the completion of His mission. He returned back to base. He came to earth with a mission in mind, and He returned to heaven having accomplished that mission. Philippians chapter 2 verse 9 and say 10 says this: therefore God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth. And also Revelations chapter 1 verse 17 to 20, John says this, John the Apostle: when I saw him, I fell at his feet as though dead. But he placed his right hand on me, saying, do not be afraid. I am the first and the last and the living one. I was dead, and see, I am alive forever and ever, and I have the keys of death and of Hades. Dear friends, he returned back to base. Mission accomplished. Secondly, it also tells us, confirms to us, that he has now united fallen humanity with God the Father and given the good news to us. This is what Paul says in his letter to the Corinthians. Jesus reconciled man to God, and he also gave us the ministry of reconciliation. John 14:6, that well-known verse: I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Jesus was resurrected by the Father, and that resurrection was affirmed, and the completion of his mission was symbolized or was proved through the ascension back to heaven. And also in Acts chapter 1 verse 3, Luke records this: after his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convicting proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. Jesus appeared to many witnesses, and he testified, he confirmed the message about the kingdom of God. It was not only a message now, but it was also a living message now, because the herald of the message was alive among the witnesses. Dear friends, it affirms Jesus' resurrection and completion of his mission. When I was thinking about this, about the event which we read about, which happened on the mount called Olivet, I was reminded of two things. One was, when I was around 11 years of age, a few of us family members went to the Bandaranayake International Airport to bid farewell to my favorite auntie, my father's sister. And I can still remember, and I can identify with the disciples who were looking heavenward, can still remember in that gallery area, lobby area, looking through that huge glass window at the airplane which my auntie and my uncle was flying on to the United Kingdom. Till the plane was to be seen no more, I kept on looking. The disciples kept on looking because it was their Lord, it was their teacher, it was their master, it was their friend who was departing from them. And the second thing I was reminded was when I was listening to a CNN newsroom telecast this last week. The owner of the Dallas Mavericks, a basketball team from the state of Dallas, Mark Cuban, was being interviewed because he was part of a movement, part of an enterprise which was making sure that people did not lose their livelihoods, but that they were sustained and they were paid for by the hour. CNN was interviewing him, and also there was a question of what does the future hold? When will the basketball league begin again? When will they be back in business? And one statement that Mark Cuban made really stuck with me. It was actually a question, and he was asking, who do we trust? Everything has fallen apart, our structures have fallen apart, our systems have fallen apart. He was saying initially the President Trump seemed as if he was one who could be trusted, but now he is also a fake. Who can we trust? And from my living room here in Kohala, Sri Lanka, I was shouting out, trust in Jesus. Trust in Jesus. Here is the greatest Protestant nation in the world and a fairly rich, affluent, educated person in the United States of America. He's asking the question, who can we trust? And I just wanted to shout out through that TV screen, trust in Jesus. Dear friends, that glorious homecoming affirmed that Jesus was truly the Lord and Jesus was truly the way to the Father. He returned back to base. He had now united, taken away the division between God and man, between God and his creation. And he had also left behind many witnesses so that his legend, his agenda, his ministry would continue. But this glorious homecoming of our Lord also reminds us or calls forth to us to live in hope of another glorious homecoming. And that is what exactly the angels reminded the disciples. Why are you looking heavenward as if everything was finished? As if there was no hope. This same Lord will return in the same way. Therefore, go and do what he asked of you to do. And therefore, my dear friends, even as I want to remind you that the ascension affirms Jesus' resurrection and gives us a sign that he completed his mission on earth, I also want to share with you a few things about what the ascension reveals to us about what we are to do, or let me phrase it in a different way, what the Lord expects of us. And I take you to John chapter 14, where the Lord clearly revealed to his disciples what it is that he expects from them. John 14:3 says this, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you myself to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also." Jesus went to heaven to prepare a place for you and me, to prepare a place for all those who believe in our Lord as their Savior. Dear friends, are we people who believe in Him and Him alone? Have we placed our trust on Him? See, in a time like this, where death, devastation, uncertainty is seemingly ruling all around, it is important for us to revisit our own lives, our own hearts, and to examine, re-examine where our trust is, where our faith is, where truly we have put our belief in. As Mark Cuban expressed, the owner of Dallas Mavericks, all the structures are falling apart. All the systems are proving to be ineffective. And Jesus says, or he said to his disciples, "I go, and I know you are sad that I am going to be no more, but I go in order that I may prepare a place for you in eternity. And I will return to take you there." Take whom? All those who believe in Him. Secondly, my dear friends, John 14, chapter 12, says, verse 12 says this, "Very truly, I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and in fact will do greater works than these, because I am going to the Father." Our Lord accomplished such a lot when He was on this earth. He healed many. He did perform many miracles. He taught a lot. He gave us an example, a model. He did many works. And we reflect on the works of Jesus when we read the Gospels in the Bible. But He also says here, He told His disciples and He tells the same thing to us today, "I want you to do my work. I want you to be my hands on earth now. I want you to be my feet now on earth. And because you believe, you will do the works that I do." And I believe Jesus is not only referring to the miracle, the miraculous the supernatural that will take place when we believe in Him and pray in His name. But I believe that He was referring to the lifestyle that He lived, to the example that He gave, and the way He thought, the way He spoke. And we are called to live like Him. And when I thought of this these days for our family devotions, we are reading the book of Judges because we feel that it's relevant to our times. And in Judges, there is a judge, one of my personal favorites, called Gideon. In Judges chapter 6 verse 11, Gideon's call is recorded. Now the angel of the Lord came and sat under the oak at Ophrah, which belonged to Joash the Abiezrite, that is Gideon's father. As his son Gideon was beating out wheat in the wine press to hide it from the Midianites. The Midianites was the Gentile nation, army, enemy that was persecuting, that was ruling over the Israelites at this particular time. And Gideon was involved, was busy with finding food for his family and storing it up. And as he was doing this, the angel of the Lord reveals himself and calls Gideon to a greater calling. I also want to read from verse 25 onwards, because that really was an eye-opener. I had read through Judges many times before, but when we were reading this one family devotion time, this verse and what was being said really came through to me. Verse 25. That night the Lord said to him, that is Gideon, take your father's bull, the second bull, 7 years old, and pull down the altar of Baal that belongs to your father. The altar of Baal that belongs to your father. Think of it. And cut down the sacred pole that is beside it. Asherah pole. And build an altar to the Lord your God on the top of the stronghold here, where the altar of Baal stood before. In proper order, then take the second bull and offer it as a burnt offering with the wood of the sacred pole, Asherah, that you shall cut down. Verse 27. Gideon was also a human like us. So Gideon took 10 of his servants and did as the Lord had told him. But because he was too afraid of his family and the townspeople to do it by day, he did it by night. He did it, my dear friends. He did what the Lord God commanded him to do it. He did it during a time when the word of the Lord came to him, where he was engrossed, involved, interested in the mundane, in the day-to-day life, in securing provisions for his family during this time of great attack, time of great difficulty. But the Lord opened his eyes and wanted him to do what he commanded. And the remarkable thing is this. When the Lord or the angel of the Lord appeared to Gideon at that wine press, Gideon asks a question. If the Lord is with us, how come we are experiencing all this difficulty and devastation? And to that question, the angel did not reply. But I'm sure after what Gideon had to do that night, Gideon would have come to a recognition. Oh, the Lord is with us, but our sin is keeping his blessing, his true desire for us, away from us. My dear friends, that was just an aside, but I wanted to share that with you, because sometimes we can be doing so many things thinking that we are doing the Lord's will. But here, to the disciples, Jesus made it very clear, you will do what I have done. And even in the great commandment, the great commission, pardon me, Jesus made it very clear that he wants them to do and to teach what Jesus taught and observed. So it reveals to us what we are to believe, because he is the Lord. We are to believe in him. And it also reveals to us what we are to do, because he has done all of that before us. Finally, John 14 verse 16 says this, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate, helper, to be with you forever. Dear friends, this ascension shows us the coexistence that is there among the divine Godhead. It reveals to us that Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit are united in their work, in their existence. And it calls forth to us to unite with God, to cooperate with God, to abide with God through the presence of the Holy Spirit. Daily we are to seek after this. Daily we are to examine ourselves whether we abide in him. There is, of course, the great chapter about abiding in John 15, which follows this instruction that our Lord gave his disciples about his departure. So a glorious homecoming. The first incident, the ascension of our Lord, proves to us, establishes that he truly completed his mission. And as his witnesses, he has entrusted the faith to us, the gospel to us, so that we will continue by the power of the Holy Spirit to be his witnesses on this earth. And it also reveals to us what we are expected to do. We are expected to believe in him, trust in him totally. We are expected to do what he desires through our lives. And we are expected to do this by abiding in Him through the Holy Spirit. Dear friends, may the Lord bless us and help us so that we could also experience that wonderful, glorious homecoming when we go back to our true homes, which the Lord has Himself prepared for us. God bless you all. Amen.